Hello and welcome to this WEALTHTRACK podcast. I'm Consuelo Mack. Our focus today is Wall Street from an insider's point of view and whether it deserves its Wolf of Wall Street and Flash Boys reputation for being a greedy, selfish, amoral, or immoral money-making machine mostly for itself. Our guest is Jason DeSena Trennert, founder, managing partner, and chief investment strategist of Strategas Research Partners, an independent macroeconomic policy and markets research firm serving institutional investors. And Jason has been ranked among the top investment strategists of Wall Street over the years. He is also a prolific writer, penning columns for the Wall Street Journal, the Financial Times, and essays for his clients in a wide variety of topics. And his most recent tome is autobiographical. It is My Side of the Street, Why Wolves, Flash Boys, Quants, and Masters of the Universe Don't Represent the Real Wall Street. Jason, welcome to WealthTrack.
Thank you for having me, Consuelo.
I'm delighted to have you here, and you've been a guest on WealthTrack many times over the years. I have to say, you're also one of the most honest and nicest guys I know in any profession.
I had a lot of fun reading the book.
Yeah, well, the insight into you was terrific, but it also gave us a lot of insight into Wall Street, and that's why I'm interviewing you today. So, you know, you've been on the street about 27 years. Who does represent the real Wall Street?
Yeah, you know, I think the reason why I wrote the book is that I've been doing this long enough to know that there's a tendency, of course, for, and this is a world where, of course, drama sells, and you kind of lose some nuance at 140 characters per text or whatever it is. But
right.
I really think I've been doing this, again, long enough, and I worked at Morgan Stanley, and I worked at Merrill Lynch, and then I worked at an independent research firm called ISI, and then I have my own shop. And to answer your question directly, Wall Street's made up of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, probably altogether, of people that take the subway to work every day and pay the mortgage and do all the kind of the mechanics of helping people save for their own retirements and try to build wealth. And it's not to say that there aren't bad actors, but I would say that there are bad actors in every business. And unfortunately, there's a certain nature of the business where people tend to focus on the negative almost to the exclusion of the positive. But the real Wall Street, I would say, in the most platonic, quote-unquote version of it, are the people that I would say are my clients. They're institutional investors who come into work every day and take their roles as fiduciaries, which is, putting the interests
first
of their clients ahead of their own. That, to me, represents the real Wall Street. And that's, in terms of numbers, that greatly, surpasses any of the wolves or the flash boys or the quants or any of that sort of stuff.
Right. And yet, there are fiduciary standards that are trying to be legalized on a federal level. And, much of Wall Street is fighting it, kind of tooth and nail. So why do you think that is, if, in fact, you're saying that the real Wall Street is acting in a fiduciary manner, putting the interests of clients first?
Yeah, I think a lot of this, it can be, I think, traced back to the time when before brokerage firms were public companies and when they were partnerships. And I think it was in those days, in some ways, one could claim that it's inefficient because a lot of those companies didn't necessarily have permanent capital. They couldn't get bigger. Having said that, or they could get only bigger very slowly or very prudently. Having said that, as someone who runs my own partnership, I feel very strongly that a partnership is the best risk management tool ever created, because you treat your own money differently than you might treat other people's money, and especially if it's faceless money that's shareholders in a very, very large corporation. I also think, to be very fair,
let me just reiterate that the partnership you think is the best way is the best kind of almost like a governor for a fiduciary standard, because your partner's money is your client's money, and there's no separation. Right?
Precisely.
Yeah.
And again, some might call it inefficient because it slows things down. But by the same token, it's harder to blow things up. And I feel very strong in the. I know a lot of the discussion about the financial industry obviously became very very dramatic after the financial crisis, as it should. And I think a lot of people are still very scarred by the financial crisis, as they should, as anyone that's been in the business who takes it seriously has. I also feel very strongly that the financial crisis wasn't caused by fraud. That fraud was a natural, I would say, just a natural byproduct, if you will, of a very long period of speculative excess. And that's not an excuse. It's just, it's important, I think, for people to understand that in many ways we're all part of the same hypocrisy of the financial crisis that came about in 2007 and 2008. And so, and a lot of people were complicit in that. And again, I'm not excusing bad behavior, and as someone who loves the industry, I want to almost in some ways save it from itself, because I do think it's a big part of the reason why America has been America has been the depth of its capital markets, and that it hasn't been as reliant upon banks per se. It's been had very deep capital markets, which has allowed you to turn money into capital, which is an important part of wealth creation.
I'm so glad you brought that up, because certainly if you were to go to Europe, you know, we don't have the kind of equity markets that if you want to, and debt markets that they have here, that if you want to borrow money as a corporation in Europe, you've got to go to a bank. You don't have the kind of access to the capital markets. And that's another question I wanted to ask you is, it's you're a Wharton graduate, so you're a financial historian, you studied this stuff. So it's kind of, and what is the real Wall Street is, and to put this into context, 42% of the U.S. population in a survey that was taken by Pew last year believes that Wall Street hurts the economy, 42%.
Yeah.
45% believe that it helps it, that Wall Street helps it. But, so what is the key function that Wall Street performs in the economy? I think it's really important that we understand the role that Wall Street plays in the economy.
Yeah, it's great. I'm so happy you make this a mutual admiration site. I'm so happy you asked that question, because I think that Charlie Merrill, who is the founder of Merrill Lynch, he was
right.
One of the first people to say, and this was it must be 70 or 80 years ago, that there's no such thing as Wall Street. There's Main Street in every small town in America, and that is Wall Street. That is the key function, and professionals talk about Wall Street. You might have heard the term capital markets, and the function of Wall Street is to create capital, is to build capital, is to raise capital for companies that are growing. Money, I think there's a tendency to confuse the concepts of money and capital. And money is inert, is really just, let's say that would just be cash. Mm-hmm. Capital allows banks and other financial players, whether they be speculators or whether they be long-term investors, to help people that have ideas, helps them turn them into reality by giving them loans or access to equity or debt markets. So that's the function, really, of Wall Street. And again, I think it's a very important part. It's hard to understand the American economy, how great the American economy has become, how big it's become, without understanding that that's been a very important part of how we've done it. As you mentioned, Europe is still very much dependent upon banks themselves. And so you only have one kind of ability to raise capital, largely through loans. And they do have equity and debt markets, of course, but they're just not as deep. The problem with being so dependent upon banks, per se, is that it takes, first of all, it's a little bit slower, but also it takes a long time for problems to be recognized and fixed. The capital markets, while they can be awfully fast and they can feel frightening at times, there is a certain Darwinian aspect of it that allows you to recognize problems and opportunities much more quickly. And so it's a bumpy ride, and I know it makes people, and I understand fully, it can make people feel very uncomfortable, but it also, on the whole, I've never seen a system that's kind of created more wealth for more people than the system that we've had in the United States.
Yeah. One of the issues that comes up a lot in Americans, you know, really feeling of concern about kind of the way the U.S. economy is going, and Wall Street specifically, is the income inequality that we're seeing. You know, it's become a huge national issue. And, you know, Wall Streeters are extremely well paid. And, you know, compared to just about any other industry.
I'm trying to think of what the alternative would be. Because I am a free market person. I tend to think free markets are better allocators of capital than, let's say, small groups of people in that are unaccountable, let's say, like a government,
right,
in terms of price fixing or things along those lines. So I don't know how to solve that problem, although I'm very sympathetic to the idea that there is great income inequality in the U.S. I would argue that investment bankers aren't the only ones that are benefiting from the income inequality. There are a lot of other people in society, anyone really that owns financial assets, homes, real estate, financial assets have benefited greatly. And I would argue, and this gets more into economics and the markets, I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we have very easy monetary policy and actually quite tight regulatory policy. So we've added a lot of the Fed has increased the size of its balance sheet by over five times in the past 6 or 7 years, and yet most of that excess liquidity is going into bank reserves, which is finding its way into financial assets. It's not really finding its way into the real economy. Economists are talking about something called the velocity of money. And the irony is that the velocity of money has declined. The ability of all that money to actually get into the real economy has actually declined quite a bit, but the value of stocks, bonds, and real estate has gone up quite a bit. That, I think, in my view, is the irony is I think a lot of government policy is contributing in many ways to the great income inequality that you have. As far as investment banker pay, it would be difficult for me to come up with a solution aside from the fact that I do think the partnership model the pay was much more commensurate with what other professionals, doctors, lawyers, accountants, all the rest of it was. When they become public companies, it changed quite a bit.
As you said, it's faceless money. It's somebody else's money, and that makes a big difference. You know, kind of along the same lines of compensation is that one of the things that Americans are unified on, whether they're, you know, liberals or conservatives or Democrat or Republicans, is that something like 80% of Americans feel that there should be stiffer penalties against financial fraud. Note, one of statistics kind of cited is that if you look at the CEOs, the top execs of the major investment firms, the major banking firms, coming out of the crisis on Wall Street, that, you know, there have been very few indictments, that none of the top honchos have gone to jail. And a lot of Americans feel that that's a problem, whereas, you know, shareholders suffered, the economy suffered from the risks that Wall Street and bankers took. What's your view?
Yeah, I think, you know, and I saw one of the candidates on the Democratic side, Mr. O'Malley, has talked about that. I think you have to be very careful, though, and there has to be a distinction between out-and-out fraud, where you're trying to hurt somebody else, and, for lack of a better term, stupidity. And I think many of us were caught up, all of us in some way,
all
or somewhat complicit with the bubble, the creation of the bubble and its eventual bursting. And so I'm not particularly sympathetic to the idea that some of the CEOs should be in jail, let's say. I think I'm very much in favor of financial fines of people that actually committed fraud, to go to jail, to pay the penalty, all the rest of it. But I think in many ways, the concept of too big to fail, again, one of the great ironies about banks, this criticism that they were too big to fail, I would argue in some ways is worse now than it was 6 years ago. And so you're going to have many of, if you were to have another financial crisis, I personally right now I think it's pretty unlikely, but if you were, in many ways you'd have the same problems. It actually would be harder to fix now than it was 6 or 7 years ago. So I'm not coming up with particularly good solutions. What I am, maybe part of the point of the book, though, too, is to say that part of the problems that we've seen on Wall Street aren't because Wall Street is made up solely of soulless overachievers that are trying to defraud other people. That if anything, there are certain structural things on Wall Street or that have been created on Wall Street that need to change or maybe go back to the way they were. Glass-Steagall is an example that would greatly reduce some of the risks. And also in some ways, again, maybe help Wall Street save it from itself or in terms of its own reputation.
I have a couple more questions for you. You mentioned that you are, you know, pro-free markets. Are we seeing a self-correcting mechanism on Wall Street? I know, for instance, anecdotally that, you know, the top business school graduates of the Whartons of the world and whatnot, that investment banking is no longer the top choice of, you know, like 40% of the class. I've talked to a couple of investment bankers about it, and they're saying, you know, it's not as much fun anymore. There are too many compliance officers. You can't, you know, you work really right. hard, but there aren't the benefits that there were. I mean, is there a kind of self-correcting going on Wall Street that it is going to be a different place?
I think so, and I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. And I talk about, again, not to keep talking about the book, but I talk in the book, a chapter is on business school. And one of the things that I think is unfortunate about a lot of business schools, and there's no way to solve this per se, is that too many people wound up becoming financial engineers and not real engineers. Or too many people wound up going to Wall Street or, let's say, management consulting firms or other very, very highly remunerative careers. Not enough
right.
people from business schools, let's say the Harvards, the Whartons, the Stanfords, in my view, not enough were going into, let's say, industry. You know, not enough were going to work mm-hmm. at Caterpillar or Deere or, you know, pick, you know, any of the kind of Fortune 500 companies. And that was very unbalanced. And I think to the extent to which Wall Street is being regulated, there is somewhat of a new normal. It is good that more of the country's talent, if you will, business talent, is going into other industries. And I think it's also people that really love Wall Street, as I do, will still be attracted to it, will still go to it. It may not be as much fun. It may not be as highly paid, but you'll probably get more people going to the industry for the right reasons as opposed to simply going for the paycheck. And of course, we're all human beings. Everyone's interested in the paycheck. You'll never completely get rid of that. But the fact that it's a little bit more balanced now, I think, is a good thing.
Yep. Final question for you. You have a son who's, 12? Would you be happy to see him go on Wall Street? Would you recommend Wall Street to him for a career path?
There's another great question because this is a parlor game. I play with a lot of my buddies, after work. A lot of times we're having a drink or something. We talk about this. And there's more of a sense now that you wouldn't. That you hear more of that. More people that I know, friends of mine, say, you know, I would never send him into this business or her into this business. I feel somewhat differently because I think it's the best. I think intellectually it's the best business there is. I think everything has some sort of investment conclusion or investment implication. You read a lot. You meet a lot of interesting people. Learn a lot. I think also the fact that it's not so easy is a good thing. I think that for people in terms of your character, it's probably good that it's not that easy.
Jason DeSena Trennert, my side of the street, why Wolves, Flash Boys, Quants, and Masters of the Universe don't represent the real Wall Street, and you certainly do represent a portion of the real Wall Street, and it's just great to have you on WealthTrack, and it's a terrific book, Jason. I really loved reading it, so I recommend it to all of our audience.
Thank you so much, Consuelo, for everything, and keep up the great work with the show and your podcast.
Yeah.
Thank you.